This video is about a project that started out looking simple but ended up being a lot more difficult than I had predicted. And it's about a whistle, and here you can see the end result. This is a Lionel, it's called a WS-75. It's a pre-war whistle with a zinc casting, a special relay to activate it, and of course a motor. Bought it online, and you'll see as I show you the details of how everything evolved, what was wrong with it, and then what I had to do to it. But let's look at the result. And right now I have my output voltage set for about 8 on my ZW transformer. And you can see it emits a pretty decent whistle sound. You hear a lot of motor noise, which is typical because the motor is old, some of the bearings are worn, but more or less the whistle sound predominates, and it's really right now seems to be working well. A couple of features you'll notice right away: I had to make a bracket to hold my relay to the whistle because the casting was broken. And you can see around the back of the casting a copious amount of very, very strong air-resistant tape to seal this up. And again, I'll explain in the later part of the video why all this took place. But let's listen to it again. You can see that relay close as I operate the whistle. And we're only putting 8 volts to it. My hope was to use this possibly with a standard gauge 392, which typically runs 18 volts. So if I wanted to use it with a higher powered locomotive, I would probably need a dropping resistor, and it would be placed where you see this brown wire right now, probably on the order of 8 ohms. Because you don't want to drive the whistle with too high a voltage. It will not whistle, it will not sound good at all. Pretty much 8 volts for this particular whistle is optimum. So we'll continue the video, and you'll hear the steps that led us to what presently is in place. And I hope you enjoy what follows. Again, thank you for watching, and more will be forthcoming. Oh, one more thing. When I bought the whistle, just so you can see it, this was the impeller, which is a little fan blade that's in the back of the housing. It actually spins and makes your sound. This is how I bought it. Not much left. So again, let's hope you enjoy what follows about the development of the whistle and all the things that can go wrong with it. Any effort to repair one of these whistles has to come with a pretty thorough understanding of exactly how it works. Here, taken from a Lionel service manual, is Lionel's sketch of the whistle, a WS-75, used in some O-27 sets back in the 1930s. Some of the more important features I've noted with arrows and text. Upper left, you see gasket. The housing, which are the whistle chambers, and the back, which is a steel plate, have a gasket in between. And this is to make certain that these are completely airtight. And we'll go over the airtight issue in a little bit of detail later. The center text and arrow is the impeller, which is basically just a fan blade attached to the armature and pretty much in the center of the whistle. To the right, upper right, is one of 7 or 8 groove pins. This is how the back was attached to the casting. They're not screws, they're grooved pins and they're driven in. So if one wants to remove the back, one has to pry out the groove pins. And subsequently, you can replace them by drilling and tapping number 440 and using a short number 440 screws, which is what I've done with mine. In the bottom, you can see arrows pointing to the brushes,
which have springs behind them, and you can see a little bit of the face of the armature upon which the brushes press. And bottom right, the DC relay, operated by DC voltage from the transformer. The relay will close, and this applies power to the whistle assembly. The impeller blows air through at high speed, and the chambers make a whistling sound. So that's what you hear when everything works well. Here's a view of the cast housing of the whistle. These are cast zinc, and typical with old cast zinc housings is something called zinc pest, or zinc warpage, or zinc deterioration. But anyway, the foreign metals in the zinc cause it to distort, and that's one of the problems with the whistle that I have here, as I found out. But the housing itself has two chambers. On the left, you can see the low frequency chamber. On the right, the high frequency. Air blowing through these produces two different tones to give you the nice whistle sound that you hear when they're working properly. Here is one photo of what I purchased. You'll notice the DC relay sitting alongside has been broken off because the casting actually broke. This is fairly common. I've seen this problem before, and of course my solution was to make a little bracket. I drilled and tapped the stub of the casting and attached the housing, which is the whistle relay, which is tapped to number 6, and screwed the two together. You can see the armature in there looks complete in this particular one. You can see the brush plate is missing all the screws as I bought it. And you can see in the back, if you look carefully at the casting and the cover, you can see a gap, and you can see that the casting looks to be bowed. This is more prevalent in the next picture, so let's take a look at that. Here's a picture of the back of the whistle assembly, and in these old ones, you can see the bronze bushing held in place by a spring clip. This gave a little pressure to the armature to push it against the brushes and the brush springs that were on the opposite side. And here again, you can see it's missing almost all the screws. The pins have been removed because somebody was obviously inside of it. And one thing I couldn't tell is that the armature really wasn't present. You saw the piece of the armature that I took out of it. And also in the picture, you really couldn't see that the brushes were missing, although those are a relatively trivial item. They only cost a few dollars. The impeller, however, was significantly expensive, $5 plus $5 shipping. So it adds substantially to the cost of this. And again, the bushing, what I had to do ultimately with that bushing is to heat it very, very hot with a soldering iron and solder it to the bracket. Because as they get old and worn, they spin when the armature spins, and they make an ugly sound. You don't want to hear it. So I had to solder it in place. So what did I have to buy? Well, once I took it apart, I found out that it had no brushes or brush springs. So I had to buy those. You see them shown in the left-hand pane of this photograph. And I also had to buy an impeller. The new impellers are plastic, really no big deal. These are plastic, they're very tough, but I did have to grind off the dome so that this would fit in the older whistle motor. So I spent a little bit of time doing that, and then I could press it onto the shaft. And at my delight, when I first put power to it, the motor actually spun. And when I put power to the DC relay and activated the whistle control, the DC relay actually worked. But pretty much that's where my utopia ended. So let's wrap this up by talking about what I did to make this work again. First of all, here's the picture of the front of the whistle, the brush side where the armature face is. And you can see the little piece of brass that I fashioned to make a bracket. I bent it so it has some stiffness to it. It looks a little kludgy, but it does work. It supports the relay nicely. And you can see a little bit of witness of some of the tape coming around the back to the front. And I added a wire to the field from the relay. This is what completes the path of power to turn on the whistle motor. So that was gone, so I displaced in that wire. If we wanted to run this at a higher voltage, that wire would be replaced with a resistor, perhaps 8 ohms, and it would have to be a power resistor, but those are readily available and you could fit one into this size assembly. So not that much to see on the front. Of course, behind the two copper tubes you see are the brushes and springs that I had to purchase and replace. But most of the action took place at the impeller side, so let's take a look at that next. In reading some excerpts from the Lionel service manual, which is really very well done, reading it, copies online exist, I found out that one of the most important things about these whistles is that you can have not even the most minute air leak, or the whistle will not whistle. Also, needless to say, the impeller must turn in the proper direction. In this picture, you can see the impeller sitting back in there. You can see a couple of the blades. And also in this picture, you can see the number 440 screws that I added to this in place of the original drive screws, but the bushings that were put in place to hold the rear cover on. And of course, also you can see the copious amount of tape that I used to seal the entire perimeter, without which it still wouldn't whistle. But last but not least, what I actually decided to do, you could see from the pictures of the housing when I purchased it, it was warped. So I actually took the armature and brushes out of the housing, and I got a piece of very heavy 60 sandpaper, gritty sandpaper, and a flat surface. And I just moved the housing back and forth along that sandpaper until it became flat. So it took some material away, but it did flatten it. And I think without the flattening process, this thing never was going to whistle. The motor turned just fine, but no whistle sound emanated. Last but not least, when I thought I was in pretty good shape, the bushing began to spin because I had to drill it out and modify it so that everything would fit. So in order to keep that from happening, you see gobs of solder, because this takes a lot of heat. The bushing is phosphor bronze and really doesn't like to take solder. It does hold lubricating oil. So the whole idea was you're supposed to lubricate this thing just by lubricating the bushing. I did lubricate it before I put it together, but you still hear a lot of motor sound because things are old and shaky, not that great. And I can play with the chambers a little more. I think I could make the whistle sound a little more robust than it is. But for the time being, it's whistling. I was happy because basically it came from nowhere to what you see right now. And I think you could probably put it in a locomotive. So I hope the video's been informative. Again, we always hope to do more in the future, so we're glad to have you watch and hope you have a great day and stay safe. Thanks for viewing.